In 1851, Helen Valentine slumped down in her chair beside her overly cluttered desk. She sighed loudly, but nobody was in the office to hear her. She still had far too many submissions and editorials to look through, and it was already after lunch. Why was it her job to tell all these prospective poetesses that their simple rhyming structures would never get them through the world? Read the makeup section of her massively successful magazine and wait for a rich man to set you right. The world had no space for these girls. But for all the cynicism in the mind of 17 Magazine's editor-in-chief, one poem stuck out. This was different from the rest. Underdeveloped, sure, but in the way that the creative, reckless spirit still shone through. Spring, it was titled. Reading it once more, and after checking no one was looking, once more again, she grinned, still fatigued, but reminded why she loved her job. This was the sort of young woman she wanted in her reader base. She glanced the name on the submission. Audrey Lorde, Hunter High School, age 17. Miss Lorde, Helen could already see, would go on to create a powerful presence in the world. Hello, my name is Mia, and this is the third time I'm recording this intro because my dog will not stop barking. Welcome to Rainbow Relics, a very, very professional series that tells you all about the queer people who shape this world's history. And this week is all about American self-proclaimed poet, mother, feminist, pioneer, lover, and survivor, Audrey Geraldine Lorde. Links to the sources and further reading are listed in the description below. The 18th of February, 1934, saw immigrant parents Linda Gertrude Beaumont Lorde and Frederick Byron Lorde welcome to their small Harlem home their third and final daughter. The housekeeper from Grenada and the real estate agent from Barbados surely could not have imagined the impact that tiny, mewling infant would have throughout and beyond her lifetime. As a child, Lorde was bullied relentlessly by her sisters and later her classmates for being so tongue-tied she could barely speak, as well as being nearsighted to the point of being classed as legally blind. Despite the setback, however, Lorde still learned to read and write by the age of 4, guided by her mother. Upon attending St. Mark's School at the beginning of her education, she was far more adept compared to her classmates. During the first lesson on writing, the children were given large sheet music books and black crayons to practice letters with. Little Audrey had been taught at home that under no circumstances should one write in crayon, and definitely not within a music book. She sat in the classroom imploring the teacher for a pencil, crying that she couldn't write with a crayon. The teacher misinterpreted this panic for stupidity and insisted on Audrey completing the task. Finally, in shaky letters, Audrey wrote her full name down the page. Needless to say, the teacher was absolutely furious. This headstrong attitude and high ambition was something Audrey had inherited from her mother and carried throughout her life. If anything, it may be one of her most famous qualities and the one she was most proud of. Early in her life, she decided she disliked the spelling of her name, for example. Originally spelled with a Y at the end of Audrey, she removed it because she felt the symmetry of her name worked better without it, of course. When she attended Hunter High School as their first ever black student, she attempted to publish a poem in the school journal publication. However, she was turned down because the poem, named Spring, was too provocative. Never one to be deterred, Lorde went straight to 17 Magazine, and her poem was published within its pages almost instantly. It's no real surprise to any of those around her that Lorde would pursue a life of poetry. Due to her speech difficulties as a child and the early age at which she learned to read, she began expressing herself by reciting poems. Her memory was highly notable, and she had little difficulty in memorizing multiple poems. But at the age of 12, she ran into a dilemma. She felt emotions and experienced aspects in her life that she had never read in any poem before. Her emotions became too subtle to describe in someone else's words. Would this deter Lorde from the medium of poetry? Of course not. I doubt she even knew the word quit existed. She took this block in communication as a sign to begin writing her own poems, and thank goodness for the sake of the whole world that she did. There's some on-again, off-again construction happening on the road just outside my house, which is fantastic, but let's ignore that, hope it's not too bad, and continue, because we have a lot to get through. Okay, so after her success with 17 Magazine, Lord graduated Hunter High School to attend Hunter College in 1954. She did multiple small odd jobs to work her way through college, and because of this, it took her 4 years to finally receive her Bachelor of Arts in Library Science. Which, I'm not entirely sure how long a Library Science degree is, but 4 years seems normal for a bachelor's, right? Does it work different in America? Anyways, she did odd jobs, it took her 4 years, and she got her bachelor's in library science. And then in 1959, she took a trip down to Mexico, specifically visiting the Universidad Nacional Autónoma de México, if I pronounce that correctly. Mexico then was a pivotal point in Lord's life, specifically with coming to terms with her lesbianism. But get to all that good stuff once I've spoken more on her life in academia. So after Mexico, Lord came back to the United States to study for a master's degree, and this furthered her knowledge of library sciences at Columbia University in 1961. And throughout the 1960s, Lord worked as a librarian at a number of different institutes and public schools, and most notably in the Mount Vernon Public Library right up until her marriage. A year after graduating from Columbia, Lord married the attorney Edwin Rowlands, and together they had 2 children, the oldest daughter Elizabeth and the young son Jonathan. Being a mother was extremely important to Lord's identity, and I believe this was a part in her life she needed just as much as she needed her poetry and her activism. And while I couldn't find a definitive source on why exactly she got married, it must be remembered that being gay and expressing yourself was still very illegal in the 60s, regardless of the surface-level tolerance of the free love movement. Lord was a lesbian, and she really wanted to be a mother. Rowlands was a gay man who wanted to keep his identity and his life safe. Especially as an attorney, he did have a lot holding on to this. And what better way to look after your public image and still be yourself than to start a family with a close friend? And again, while I didn't have anything definitive, I think it's pretty safe to say that they cared for each other in a very deep friendship. At almost the same time as her marriage, Lord began to be more involved in the Greenwich Village queer scene, notably frequenting the bars The Pony Stable Inn and Bagatelle. She kind of stuck out like a sore thumb as a black woman and as a lesbian who fit neither into the binary of the femme or butch expressions. Today, I guess we'd probably call her a chapstick lesbian, but at that time, our language to explain our expressions was still developing. In her second published book of poetry, titled Cables to Rage, she came out to our readership and continued to speak out about lesbianism throughout pretty much all her future work. She was deemed a visionary after being nominated for a National Book Award and became almost a household name in black female and feminist circles all around the United States. Lord's poetry never pulled any punches. If you weren't angry and hopeful and emotional after reading, you probably weren't reading her work. Following on from the success of Spring, Lord never stopped writing. Even throughout her years at Hunter College and Columbia University, even while being a mother and a librarian and later an English professor, not once did poetry cease to flow from her. Her first poetry collection was titled The First Cities, which was published in 1968. But 6 years previously, her poetry made a feature in Langston Hughes' publication New Negro Poems and many other black literature publications, but The First Cities was truly all Audrey. Even through her time working at libraries, she was learning more and more that poetry was her true passion. But it was isolating being one of the few black women writers at the time. Together with her friends and fellow writers Cherry Magera and Barbara Smith, Lord founded the publishing house called Kitchen Table Women of Color Press in 1981.
Saying it like that sounds as if the idea was Lord's, but from what I could find, the brunt of the credit of the idea and the creation of the publishing house should fall on Smith's shoulders. In the late 1960s, she secured her first teaching job and became a poet in residence at Tougaloo College, and later returned to her first college to teach, even becoming the Thomas Hunter Chair of Literature. To Lord, teaching was just as much a form of self-expression as poetry, especially the literature modules that she taught. In 1970, she moved on from Hunter College to work as an English lecturer at the John Jay College of Criminal Justice, after holding teaching positions at both New York City University and Lehman College. This period of teaching overlaid her publication of her first two books that I mentioned before, The First Cities and Cables to Rage. 1970 was a busy year for Lord, both professionally and personally. Realizing that the best way for her to embrace the full extent of her sexuality was to have more free experiences with it, she asked Edwin Rollins for a divorce. He accepted to the terms, and 2 years later, Lord met the woman that would go on to be her partner for more than 20 years, Frances Clayton. They moved to Staten Island together, and this isn't important at all to any of this, but only when researching this did I realize that Staten Island was actually an island. I thought that the rest of the boroughs of New York were the island and Staten Island was connected to America. I don't know why, but yeah, that was kind of a shock to me. Anyways, back to Audre Lorde and the important story. Whilst living with Clayton on Staten Island, Lorde's poetry career absolutely exploded. In 1976, she published the book Coal, which discussed all her struggles and embraces with her identity, from being black to lesbian to a woman and every other facet of herself. In 1978, The Black Unicorn graced the shelves of United States bookstores, and many believe this to be her best and strongest collection ever released. It kind of spearheaded her fame and her voice, and may have been either the first or the final pillar to her overall legacy. Lord did just as much for lesbian and black politics as she did for lesbian and black literature. While being one of the loudest voices in many New York feminist movements, Lord was also highly critical of the Cold War, and especially the treatment of the Vietnamese civilians. Later, she looked further south, much, much further south, towards the violence of apartheid in South Africa. She was moved to create the protection group Sisterhood in Support of Sisters in South Africa, which focused specifically on trying to end gender-based and race-based violence directed towards black South African women. She stayed looking over, raising awareness for, and supporting the struggles of her South African sisters for her entire life. And in the United States too. One of Lord's driving principles was to create unity in the face of an increasing desire for segregation and isolation. During her time as a visiting professor at the Free University in Berlin in 1984, so America, Asia, Africa, Europe, she's going everywhere. So she took the time to contribute to the moving and growing Afro-German movement in the city of Berlin. And while she was leading the world in their own battles to destroy oppression, she was fighting her own and learning about yet another way the world was trying to shut out black voices and black lives. The poet and activist prided herself in her dedication to her own health and self-sufficiency, but on the 5th of September 1978, during one of her routine self-examinations, Lord felt an abnormality in her right breast. A year before, she had already been given the news that she had an 80% chance of developing breast cancer, but the assumption of an event is a very different feeling than living through it. Of course, like everything, Lord would not take the news of cancer lying down. She had already had a breast biopsy in 1977 and knew what to expect from the procedure. Documenting her experience in her first prose novel, The Cancer Journals, which she published in 1980, Lord explained that while she felt more in control during her second biopsy, there was also far more fear. There was a much greater chance now that this tumor was malignant. And sure enough, with Clayton and her friends by her side the entire time, Lord received the news of her cancer. After going through her options from the doctors and her friends, Lord deliberated over surgery, radiation, chemotherapy, dieting, vitamin therapy, immunotherapeutics, pancreatic enzymes, and far more surgical and holistic treatments. None of them had any guarantee of success, and at the end of the day, the choice was in her hands. On the 22nd of September, 1978, Lord opted for a mastectomy of her entire right breast. She thought that after all of the other options, she knew losing this part of herself had to be the final outcome. She had accepted the course her health had taken, but that didn't lessen any of the feelings of loss or sorrow. But even though, with her sadness and fear, Lord kept her head held high. In the cancer journals, she writes, "My scars are an honorable reminder that I may be a casualty in the cosmic war against radiation, animal fat, air pollution, McDonald's hamburgers, and red dye number 2, but the fight is still going on, and I am still part of it." To Lord, once death had been fully accepted, nobody had any ammunition with which they could fight against her. She was terrified, but used that fear to stir anger, to create retaliation towards the violence inflicted upon marginalized bodies, be that through military, health, or social brutality. Everything Lord did was underpinned by action and anger. After her brush with death, Lord was determined to work even harder in all her aspects of literature and activism. After the Cancer Journals received the American Library Association Gay Cactus Book of the Year Award, what a absolutely fantastic name, in 1981, Lord continued to write prose alongside her poetry. In 1983, her biomythography, as she called it, was released. Titled Zami, A New Spelling of My Name, it documented her life from childhood to publication, interspersed with history, mythology, and poetry, and was actually the book which introduced me to her in the first place. And so the year after this was released, she started her visiting professorship in Berlin. And that was also the year her third book, Sister Outsider, was released, describing the experience of having lived as a black gay woman in a time where all those identities were so highly scrutinized. And today, it is still bursting with merit and applicability. But for all this achievement and good news, pain still caught up to her. That same year, she received the news that she had been diagnosed with liver cancer in a way so callous and disrespectful that could only be experienced by a black woman from a healthcare professional. At the time, she was living in St. Croix on the Virgin Islands with her new partner, Gloria Joseph. Taking this news again as another beginning instead of an ending, Lo decided she wanted to undergo a traditional African naming ceremony. There, she was given the very apt name Gamba Adisa, a name which means warrior, she who makes her meaning known. In 1989, she published another book documenting her life with cancer entitled A Burst of Light, but for its optimistic title, it didn't shy away from heavy thought and emotion-provoking topics, much in the character we've come to know her to do. In 1990, alongside Joseph, Gamba Adisa established the Lumumba School for Truth, as well as the Women's Coalition of St. Croix. Gamba Adisa was determined to put up as much of a fuss and leave as much of an impact as she could at the end of her life. In 1991, she became New York's official poet laureate, a position which she held with dignity until her death of cancer a year later, at the age of 58, surrounded by people who loved her and a legacy that could never be lost. In 1994, her memory was made tangible with the creation of the Audre Lorde Project. Created in Brooklyn, its mission is to focus on and work with LGBTQ people of color in projects that boost community organization and communication. And it is still an active project to this day. And that is that for Audre Lorde. I feel like this episode was kind of all over the place. I don't know why. I don't know why I couldn't get it into like a functioning timeline. I couldn't decide if I wanted to do the timeline of her personal life or the timeline focusing on her work, so it kind of fluctuates between the two a little bit too much. I don't like it, but I'm gonna leave it. Tell me what you think. Yeah, that's that. Have a wonderful rest of your day, and goodbye.